their support. Thank you for your presence. We pray that you continue to lead us throughout this program. We pray that you use your God in a mighty way to deliver your word to them. And as your word is coming out, oh God, you come with signs and wonders to follow you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Holy Ghost.
Fire.
Tonight or today, I'm not going to take too much time. It's a continuation of what we did last week. Last week, we talked about number three, a lesson of the evil. And so you remember that number one was that eagle flies at the highest height.
Yes.
Don't forget, some of you don't have the pen to write. An eagle flies at the highest height.
Mm-hmm.
And as a child of God, a Christian, an eagle Christian, they expected to fly at the highest height, spiritually speaking. We did say that if you do not fly at the highest height, you can't trample upon serpent and scorpion and they don't hurt you. That the Bible says, only those that flies at the highest height, just like the wind. The Bible says nobody knows where the wind is coming from or where it's going, but you can feel the impact. That is the way a child of God is. When you fly at the highest height, the enemy cannot figure you out.
Amen.
They don't know where you're coming from or where you're going.
Amen.
Because you are like the wind that happened to be the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we say principle number two. That an ego, the higher the opposing wind, the higher the ego flies. You know what? The ego needs the opposing wind to soar, meaning difficulties, opposition are supposed to shape you to get to your destiny.
Amen.
To take you out of your comfort zone to where God wants you to be. So as a Christian, ego Christian, you should embrace opposition. You should embrace difficulty. Because these are the things that will shape you, that will make you a firebrand child of God.
Amen.
You cannot be a warrior if you don't fight war.
Mm-hmm.
Many Christians want to be called warriors, but they have never fought war.
Amen.
I don't know how that works. Shout hallelujah.
Amen.
And number three, we say that an eagle has the keenest of sights.
Yeah.
The eagles have the keenest sight of all and can sight their prey while soaring high in the sky. Shout hallelujah. That was when we stopped last week. What's the meaning? We say as an ego Christian, God expects you to have a vision. And we break the vision down into two. One is the dream. What you cannot see with your physical eyes. What you expect to be tomorrow. Where you think God will take you tomorrow. What you cannot see today, but you imagine, begin to see with your eyes open, the dream that you dream with your eyes open. Not the dream that you dream when you are asleep, but the one you are dreaming with your eyes open, your vision, your dream. What you cannot see now, but you know that through the power of God, you can see it tomorrow. What looks impossible today, but you know that it's not by might or by power, but by the Spirit of the living God, that this impossibility will become possible.
Amen.
Oh, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I said last week, what you cannot see, you cannot achieve.
Yes.
That many of us are where we are, because we don't see beyond your circumstances. You don't see beyond your situation. You only see defeat, poverty. You only see struggling. Bad oneness. You see what people want you to see. You see what they are speaking about you. You see the economic hardship.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why you dwell in poverty. You dwell in pain, in shame, in disgrace. Because you want to live your life based on what people say.
Mm-hmm.
You tailor your life, your mindset around the gossip around you. And that's why you can't make any progress. Because you are limited by what you can see.
Hallelujah.
If you see defeat, it's going to be defeat. Make no mistake about that. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, God told Jeremiah, he said, what can you see? He asked him twice in the book of Jeremiah chapter 1. Why would God ask Jeremiah, what do you see? Because he wanted to make sure Jeremiah was seeing what he wanted him to see. The question to you and I, what do you see? What you see is who you are. I want to sometime when we talk to a man of God, I said, well, we have a small church. The moment I think the street couple was listening to me, oh, it's a small church, right? Then you want to stay small. I repented immediately. I said, Father, forgive me. We are operating a growing ministry. Why? That was one of the reasons when I came down, I prayed in the church, the Lord said, break the wall. Let me begin to grow it. Since you say it's God of God. Oh, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shout hallelujah. Most of all, we wait till when we don't have any sin again where we were before. So that people will be, and say, okay, there are a lot of people now, we don't have sin anymore. Then let's look for another. No. See beyond where you are.
Amen.
Into the future.
Yes.
We tell you about Martin Luther King Jr. Mm-hmm. When he was still in slavery, poverty, things were wrong with him, and the black people in America. But he saw beyond himself. He saw beyond captivity. He said, I have a dream.
Yeah.
Now that dream not come to pass today.
Amen.
Because of that dream that you and I are here today.
Amen.
You know what would happen if we were here in the 60s and in the 50s? Talking about hardship in America, some of this will be running home. Shout hallelujah. So thank Martin Luther King Jr. for that dream.
Amen.
Because that's what is creating the path for you and I to be in America. Amen.
Amen.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So last way I say, to talk about vision, we're going to break it into two. The dream that you have. And then the spiritual insight based on the word of God. The spiritual insight as a prophetic insight. We talked about an object in your spiritual side last week. This morning, I want us quickly in the next few minutes to talk about the spiritual, the prophetic insight. What is the meaning of that? When you talk of vision, there are two parts to vision. It's not just about what you dream. Not just about what you see with your eyes open. No. It also is about the word of God. The prophecies of God. The direction of God. Where is God leading? What is God saying? A chicken Christian is a spiritually blind. Many of us fall into that category. We go to church. It's all about what we can see, what we can hear, what we feel, what we taste. If you can't see, if you can't feel, if you can't touch, there is nothing. That's who we are. Many of us, we are chicken Christians. We cannot soar. We don't see the spirit. We don't understand the direction of God. That's why we find it difficult to detect when God is about to move. You need to have an ability to discern in the spirit. We're breaking down these walls. How many people contributed to the breaking down of these walls? Many of us were thinking, oh, Pastor Jerry's business. That is when people will call you from home, you send money. The money would have used to break down the walls that is part of the work of God. You don't understand? Because you could not discern in the spirit. It was all about Pastor Jerry, or the wife, or Pastor Jerry's church. You don't understand? It was about the work of God. That is part of the work of God. Don't know every little effort, whether money or time, you spend to break down this wall, that God is breaking down your walls.
Amen.
But you don't understand? Because you could not discern. We say the word of God is coming, some people from their faith of all these people. No! It's about tapping into the anointing of that time, having discernment, seeing in the spirit. It's not that because Pastor Jerry is not anointed, that's why he's picking other people. When I go out to preach, I preach in churches that the pastors are very anointed. But why do they give me pulpit to preach? Why do people embrace me? Because they see into the spirit about what God wants to use me to do in their lives. They tap into it. Some will give me money. Some will want to pay or host me in their homes to feed me. Not that I need money to be fed, not that I need to be fed, but because they understand, they can see into the spirit. Spiritual insight. We can figure out the times and seasons of the move of God. We get hampered by mundane things that further clog our vision. A spiritually blind person is unable to see nor understand the direction and the move of God. So before we say, let's pray. Oh, this fasting every week. Please. My other church, they were not doing that. Because you can't get it. That when there's a time set aside by the church, it's a time that the power of God is moving. You don't want to be a part of it. Because this is too much. Because you cannot discern in the spirit. There's a Bible study. You don't show up. Why would I show up? Is it not somebody told me I went to Bible school? I studied Bible. I'm a bachelor's in degree, whatever. I sympathize with you. He said, but why do you? I said, because you are ignorant. What you learn is academic Bible, not the spiritual Bible. You can quote every verse, and yet you don't understand. Who told you people that are doing wonders for God have bachelor's or PhD in Bible? Some people even go to school. Oh, shout hallelujah. We need to see beyond where we are. The Lord is good.
All the time.
Say, tell somebody, see beyond yourself.
See beyond yourself.
Oh, I can feel that. Say, see beyond yourself.
See beyond yourself.
Amen.
Amen.
Some people only see, a spiritually blind person is unable to see and understand. Such person only sees with the naked eyes. But spiritually, undescending. Look at the Bible says, John 4, verse 24. God is a spirit. Mm-hmm. And they that worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Hallelujah. What's the meaning of that? Worshiping God in spirit is not to fake humility before man. Mm-hmm. Today I wanted to come and speak to people. Men of all fake humility. Mm-hmm. So I said, by the way, because you come where people are talking, you don't talk. Say, this is very humble. Please stop deceiving yourself. Mm-hmm. No, that can't do this. He doesn't talk. Mm-hmm. They are faking humility.
Mm-hmm.
Because we believe that people that talk that say their mind are not humble.
Thank you.
It is not to speak in tongues and trust and want to appear very religious. Mm-hmm. That is not worshiping his spirit. Some people will come on your head. We're like the Muslim people.
Amen.
They are so religious. They carry big Bible. Yeah. Oh, sister, God bless you. Yeah. Brother, oh, you are blessed. But when you see them in their research, you run away.
Man,
I remember one lady, Christian woman. She's so Christian right now. She doesn't make her hair. She doesn't wear English wears. But the one this woman was married, this was a woman that would hold the husband by the neck collar and ask the daughter to slap. But today, she's so religious.
Amen.
That's not the spirit of God.
Amen.
Stop faking humility.
Amen.
Look at what I put in the Odishan End Time Church, Revelation chapter 3, verse 18. The Spirit of God said, look, you are never cold or hot. You are lukewarm.
Yes.
Is that because you are blind? Is that you are blind? Many of us are blind in this world. So we talk about an ego vision. It's not just about the dream you have. It's about what you know about God. The vision of God. Who is God to you? We said this morning, people people will not worship God in truth and spirit because they don't know God.
Amen.
They might pretend to know God. The Laodiceans were middle of the road Christians. They could not discern the move of the power of God and flow in it. And at the same time, they did not want to appear as unbelievers. You know that? They couldn't even understand God. But they didn't want people to think that they are unbelievers. So they just mixed with the crowd. Oh my God. Say, God forbid.
God forbid.
Say, God forbid.
God forbid.
I cannot person. He's so engrossed in religiosity.
Yes.
But first to seek the Spirit to tap into the move of God. I cannot mind that person goes to church to fulfill all righteousness. To display the latest fashion, style, to find fault in the pastor, and look for co-conspirators to pull down the church of God. We go to church to find fault. To find fault. Somebody from this church that is normal wrote me a letter some time ago. And this guy abused me, insulted me. And he was supposed to be an assistant pastor. Will you, in all sincerity before God, take that letter to God and say, this is what I wrote to my senior pastor under the anointing? He called me. I prayed for 2 days. I was so restless. I said, I must respond. Thank God I did. I responded point by point. I said it to him. I thank God because that issue came up 2 days ago. And sister came to my office and approached me. This brother said, you said this to him. I said, really? Did he tell you what he wrote to me? He said, no. I said, okay, I printed. I said, take what he wrote. Take my response. Yeah. Tell him, go tell the people that he talked to, give what he wrote to me, give also my response. Because Satan wanted to use him to destroy this church.
Amen.
But they are failing.
Amen.
Why? We appear to be Christians, but we are not. What was his problem? Because I said the truth. You don't like the truth? You cannot be a child of God. I tell people, you see this church? Before God, I don't beg anybody to come to this church. If by telling you the truth you are not happy, go to where you think they will beg you, entice you to grow the number. My mission is to raise Christians that will make heaven. That was what God called me. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We need to understand and see the Spirit. The carnal-minded Christian looks for where to find fault. We find fault. Why don't you build instead of finding fault? Why don't you come to me as the founder, senior pastor, bishop, and say, hey, a man of God, you know what you said that day? I didn't quite get it. That's why I decided to come to you so we can talk about it. But no, you stood at the back and start finding fault. You are not a spirit-filled child of God. We are yet to know who God is. That's how the word of God declares in Matthew 15, verse 14. Every plant which my heavenly Father had not planted shall be rooted up. We only pray this about evil in our life. When we want to pray, we use it in prayer, in warfare. Every plant we might. But we forget one thing. It also included the house of God. Every plant not planted by God in the house of God will be rooted up. Meaning, there are some people that are planted by Satan in the house of God.
Amen.
That's the meaning. There are people that go to church, they profess Christ, but they're actually planted by Satan.
Amen.
That is the, because when we pray this, we pray about evil in our life. Everything not planted, but no. This is what the Bible talks about. Say, leave them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the ditch.
Yes.
I don't want to be blind.
Mm-hmm.
Say, I don't want to be blind.
I don't want to be blind.
Tell yourself, I don't want to be blind.
I don't want to be blind.
Some of you would not like the message of today. I wanted to preach and jump this and preach something. The Lord said, no, go and preach. The word of God must be preached the way it is.
Amen.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We're not because our time is up. Learn from Lord Abraham Nathan. I'm sure you've seen him a lot. When it was time to choose, he looked around and said, oh my God, this one is so nice. Beautiful. Is that uncle? I'll take this side.
Yes.
Yeah, but are you sure? Yes, it's okay. I'll take this side. Why? He didn't see beyond his physical.
Hallelujah.
Everything about him was what he could see, what he could feel, what he could taste. He didn't know behind or beneath that luxurious environment there was serious evil. That is that not what we see? Some of us, you want to get married, you look as a man, you look for the most beautiful woman. As a man, a woman, you look for the most handsome, light complexion, tall. It must be rich. The sister told me 2 weeks ago in my office, he said, look, pastor, I suffered enough. You know what the struggles that we have, come marry a poor man. Because it's what we can see.
Yes.
If you only you know the price you will pay for what your eyes are listening.
Yes.
That's why many of us are in the predicament we are today.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Don't you know that? The predicament you find yourself today, some of them will be traced to the marriage, the wife and the husband that you marry.
Mm-hmm.
Because you do not know the spirit of him. You're going to see the spirit. Some of them say, I need somebody that is too academically in me. Has to be.
Perfect.
Some are not going to beauty already. Say, but no. I can't stand a woman that can't speak good English. And when you find one, you look for everywhere to run to see the woman.
Amen.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God help us.
Amen.
The woman you marry and the wife, the husband you get might be short, might be tall, might be slim, might be dark. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
But what matters is that it's in the will of God for me.
Yeah.
But let me, the will of God, no matter what you go through together, you will overcome together.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
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 Finally, remember Mark chapter 4, verse 35. As I wrap this up, Jesus was in the boat. If I read that portion, please. Somebody, Mark 4, verse 30. Drop that verse 35. I use that to wrap up now. But there's something I want to say before we wrap up. Because I know my time is up here. They are signaling to me now.
Mark 4, verse 35. It says,
Now listen, please.
He said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side.
Stop there. He said, let us pass over unto the other side.
Mm-hmm.
Who was speaking?
Jesus.
Jesus spoke. He told them, he told the disciples, let us pass over. And we're going to continue this message from here. Unto the other side. And they entered the boat. All of a sudden, storm! Life-threatening storm. The boat was filled with water. They were using some stuff to scoop the water from the boat. It was rocking to and fro. The storm was overwhelming. And meanwhile, Jesus was sound asleep. I'm sure he was snoring like me. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
The disciples were so scared for their life. They were frantic. They ran to and fro. They started to scoop water. It wasn't enough. They said, no, we're going to die. No. What is wrong with this man? Eh? He said he's God. I'm sure they were thinking that. And he didn't see this storm. And look at him. He's sleeping. Go wake him up. Tell him we're dying here.
Hallelujah.
Can you imagine that? Do you know why? I mean, Jesus said In the beginning was the Word. The Word was
God.
And the Word was God. God spoke. Yet we had no spiritual insight to know that if God spoke, there can never be any storm to receive it. Because you don't see the inside, that if God spoke, no storm can sink this boat. Here there will be storm, there will be opposition, there will be affliction, and they cannot see me. Because God has spoken. The Lord of the universe has spoken. It must come to pass. So let us go to the other side. Don't you know the storm will come?
Yes, he knew.
He knew the storm would come.
Yes.
But since he's God, what can storm do to God?
Nothing.
Because they do not see beyond the storm. But of God cannot see beyond the storm.
Yes,
he said, but is it not God that said it? Do you even believe that God said it? Don't you know when God says, the enemy will fight back? And don't you know if you believe God, they cannot win over you?
You'll come out.
Papa.
You come out.
Jesus.
Okay. Oh, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When somebody's seeing something here,
you come out.
When somebody's getting something here,
I'm coming out.
They're coming out of your storm.
Yeah.
I said they're coming out.
I'm coming out.
Of that marital storm.
Yeah.
They're coming out of that immigration storm.
Yeah.
They're coming out of that financial storm.
Yeah.
They're coming out of that health storm.
Yeah.
Your children are coming out.
Yeah.
Your marriage is coming out.
Yeah.
I carry God in me, therefore I
He will inspire. He will start our next. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
So the grace of the Lord is moving from it. Somebody wants to be saved. It's a joyous moment. Let that person come out. Let that person come out.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, come on, come on. Take off your hat. Take off your hat, please. It doesn't matter. The bald head is not a problem. Pastor Daniel has a bald hat. Come to the front. Before I do that, I want you to confess Jesus Christ. Want to understand who Jesus is. Before I touch your hand, I want you to confess Jesus. Say, dear Jesus, I accept you into my life. Please come into my life. I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. But from today, I confess you with my mouth, and I believe you in my heart. That you died for my sin. Therefore, let your blood wash me now and cleanse me of every sin. Holy Spirit, I invite you into my life. Direct my steps from now henceforth, in Jesus' name. Now, to accept Jesus is that easy and simple. But as you go today, make sure that you lean on the Spirit of God. I'm going to pray for you now. The Spirit of God will lead you every step of the way. Make sure you stay away from sin. Anything that will not make the Holy Spirit to be happy, stay away from them. And ask God, anywhere you go wrong, anything that is not right, God, tell the Holy Spirit, I want to know you more. There's nothing we can do, but the Holy Spirit will do everything. Just every day, tell the Holy Spirit, I want to know you. I want to know you. I want to know you. Teach me your ways. And you begin to see the Lord speaking to you in your dream, directing you. You understand me? And find a church. If you live nearby here, find a living church. Come here for Bible studies on Wednesday, 7 p.m. Come on Sunday. Come for prayer. Whatever you can do to be close to God. If you don't live near here, look for a living church that preaches the word of God. Because when you are born again like this, you need to be close to people of God. You understand? You understand me? Yes, we're going to need to. Anybody have a Bible here? A spare Bible? Spare Bible? Yeah, that's prayer. Bring that one. Usher, please, you're going to need to bring back. We're going to need to buy some Bible. Take the Bible, my brother. Lord, we need to do this work. Every demonic entity in this life, I step on power to come by you, Jesus. I bind you, Lord Jesus, and bring us to God. You are leader than the one of God. I cast you out of this land in Jesus' name. From there, be the fire of God. Hey! To flush out every debris of time. I send them a fire. Lord, this is that fight running around. My robot, God, you have no satanic fighter running around. Jesus, God rebukes you. Jesus, God rebukes you. And I set you on fire. I cut your neck with the judgment of God. I separate you from this life. By the blood of Jesus Christ, and the blood bless you, Lord. Holy Spirit, hand it over to you. Direct the step. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us now and forevermore. Amen.
John, goodness and mercy shall follow us all of the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
But tomorrow. going to be prayer 7 p.m. Friday 7 p.m.